please the court, Alexi Holler, representing Appellant Troy Smith in this appeal. I would just like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Okay.
Inspector Gardner was the lead investigator in Mr. Smith's case. In a case that rested entirely on circumstantial evidence, Gardner claimed to have found the two critical pieces of evidence against Mr. Smith at the crime scene, the San Francisco Chronicle and a poster board which had Smith's fingerprints on them. Gardner sat at the prosecution's table during the entire trial, in which he testified 3 times he was the linchpin of the prosecution's case. At trial, he was completely unimpeached by the defense. In fact, the prosecutor was able to emphasize his considerable credibility as a witness, and Gardner himself told the jury that I pride myself on my word. What the prosecution did not reveal before trial was that the San Francisco police chief himself had previously determined that Gardner was a liar and a manipulator of evidence. Specifically, the police chief in internal affairs had concluded that Gardner, in a major state and federal investigation, had instructed another officer to destroy evidence, had submitted falsified evidence for testing at the FBI laboratory, had falsely contrived the existence of an informant.
Can you explain your theory that he could have planted the evidence in this case? Because I really have trouble understanding how he would have done that, how he would have happened to seize a newspaper and poster board that had the right fingerprints of the two defendants, bring them to San Francisco, put them there. Are you saying that he planted the fingerprints themselves, or that he, what is your theory about how he might have done this?
Well, I think, first off, I don't think that's essential for the Brady claim. I want to point out that...
Well, it goes to materiality, counsel, and that's essential for the Brady claim, so that zero, if you can zero in, because your time's ticking,
sure. On
the date stamp on the newspaper, because I understand your argument, and I'm sure Judge Freeland does, about going over to Oakland and visiting the apartment and so forth, but there's two sets of fingerprints on that newspaper from two different defendants, and it's got the date stamp of early morning, which, as I understand it, wasn't distributed in the East Bay, right?
It was, the evidence at trial suggested it was not distributed in the East Bay, correct?
Okay, so I've got the same problem Judge Freeland does, which is, what's your theory?
Well, the theory, you know, I think that that's, I think it's tough for the court to, I mean, the Supreme Court recently emphasized that the court shouldn't disregard evidence, you know, shouldn't disregard how a jury might use evidence while emphasizing, let me take that back. I mean, basically, the theory of the case is they could have shown that Gardner had the opportunity to go to his apartment. There was a missing box of documents from that apartment. Gardner himself admitted that he went to the apartment a few days after the robbery on April 9th. The newspaper and the poster board were not found on April 7th. They were found on April 9th. And even though the CSI had scoured the scene on April 7th, so we can show that Gardner had the predisposition to go to falsify evidence.
Okay, would you come back to Judge Friedland's question? So how does he think of the fingerprints of these two people on this chronicle?
On the early morning chronicle.
Well, the Doris Turner's fingerprints, Turner and Troy Smith were good friends, and so Turner was at his apartment frequently. So the fact that his fingerprints were also on the items of evidence.
But the point is, it's like perfect evidence. It's got both people on the right date. So, I mean, is your theory that he took everything from the house and then got it tested and then put the right thing in place? I mean, it's not even, the timeline doesn't even make sense. I don't understand how he could have just been so lucky to get the right thing from the house and put it in the right place. It's sort of implausible.
Well, I think the question is whether, given Gardner's prior falsification of evidence and destruction of evidence, whether it is reasonably probable that the jury would have found that this evidence, that the reliability and integrity of this evidence was not sufficient to convict him beyond.
Well, there would have to be a theory of how it could have been unreliable. I mean, even if this person, this officer, was totally unbelievable, if there's no story about how he could have even done this thing, then there's no way he did it, right? So you need a theory of how he could have been dishonest in this particular way.
Well, I think that this officer seized, the defense theory would have been that he seized items from Troy Smith's apartment and he planted them. I have to concede that there would have been coincidence that Turner's fingerprints were
also. Why does it have to be that? What if he seized it from the robbery location, from the jewelry store, and took it to the apartment? Could have both sets of prints on it then, right?
That's correct.
He's going to have to make 2 trips across the bridge is what we're trying to get at. And I guess it's not impossible, but it's sure difficult, right?
Well, I think it would have been a theory that would have been challenging to present. I do admit that. But I think there was evidence to support it. And I think that the defense was basically completely precluded from presenting the defense. I mean, that was the only possible defense.
Were both sets of fingerprints also on the poster board?
Yes.
Counsel, can I ask you some questions about the process here? Because I've got a lot of questions about the process, and I need to prioritize them. Am I correct that the process that the police department was using never did raise a flag about Inspector Gardner?
Correct.
And we don't have any explanation about why that is. It's a different officer. The original letter that went to defense counsel wasn't about Officer Gardner at all.
Correct.
And so some years had gone by. So whatever process it is that they have in place didn't flag Officer Gardner's disciplinary.
That's correct. It took multiple letters.
My next question, counsel, is whether or not he was on probation at the time he testified.
He was not on probation at that time. He was on probation at the time.
The answer's no.
Correct.
Okay, I'm just trying to help you get through your time here. So the next question is, was he on probation during the time of this investigation?
Yes.
Okay. I don't see anywhere that the Superior Court, in denying the state habeas petition, acknowledged that Gardner was put on probation or suspended at a time.
That's correct.
So do we, the state Supreme Court has said that there needs to be, that the state Superior Court should keep a record to allow appellate review, a record of what was presented for in-camera review. Do we have that?
We do not have the record here.
Do we know if it was created?
We do not know if it was created.
The Supreme Court has also said that the police is supposed to maintain, the custodian of the police record is supposed to maintain an inventory of what was presented for in-camera review. Was that created?
It was not created as far as I know.
I don't know.
I don't know. It's not in the record.
Okay. All right. So then the question is, now that this was raised, because after all, cause wasn't given, the defense counsel sent a responsive letter that said, please give me what you've got for these, I believe, five different officers, without giving any reason at all. And Inspector Gardner's materials were produced, right? Without
right.
giving any cause.
That's right.
Which seems to indicate that there was some voluntariness. But is there, do we have anything in our record to indicate that now that that flag has been raised, that it will be raised any time this individual testifies?
I have no indication on that.
All right. And do you know, and I'll certainly ask opposing counsel the other question, this next question as well, and give my colleagues a chance, but in this litigation, has the police department taken the position that a false statement by a police officer must pertain to defendant's own case before Brady is triggered?
It seems like it. Correct. And it seems like that's where the court below held. And that's where, you know, I wanted to emphasize this point. Just that, you know, even if you don't buy the plant theory, I don't think you need to go there for under the circuit's precedent. I mean, the circuit's precedent says if there is impeachment evidence against the key prosecution witness, the defense attorney, the defense is entitled to that evidence. The defense is entitled to know that that officer previously lied under oath. I mean, it goes to not just the fingerprint evidence, but this officer testified for 250 pages. Oh, that all sorts of
right.
things.
I would agree that you should have had this evidence. The question is, was it material? And at this point, do you have enough of a harmless?
Well, this is the key witness in the prosecution's case. He didn't testify just as to the fingerprint evidence. He testified as to identifications. He testified as to the investigation in all sorts of different respects. I mean, if you just review his evidence, or his testimony is 250 pages long, you can show that this person was a liar. You can show this person falsified evidence. You can show this person destroyed evidence.
So a different question. Do you have any sense of what we would learn if we got to see the part of the file that you think the court didn't review?
I have no idea, no. And I also don't know what else was not disclosed because discovery was denied below. And I think that was also obviously improper as I've raised on appeal.
So I guess I do have one last question. I'm going to make a liar out of myself because I told you that would be my last. But the briefing suggests that about 300 pages were produced.
Correct.
We have about 150.
Correct. Right, because the protective order, those were the pages that were relevant to the claims on appeal.
Which, 300 or
150? The 150.
So did you get 300?
I did get 300 pages, correct.
Right.
But the base stamp shows that there was over 1,000 pages. We only got 300 out of the 1,000.
And you're concerned about attachments?
Yes, because they have the attachments have the statements from the other officers saying that Gardner told me to destroy evidence, that Gardner told me to lie.
But since we basically know all those things, what would the attachments add to the information we already have?
Well, that's the point. I don't know. I mean, you know, I know that the attachments contain Brady material or contain evidence that should have been disclosed that was favorable to the defense because we know generally what they said, but they could have said all sorts of other things in there that we simply don't know. It's still concealed to this day.
his side, and we've taken you down to the last few seconds, but we'll make sure to give you a chance to respond.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the Court. Leif Dowd from the California Attorney General's Office. Petitioner has used his best efforts to try to sidestep and put deference here, but the San Francisco Superior Court was thorough in its analysis of the Brady claim.
I mean, the San Francisco Superior Court probably gave it the very best shot, but we can't tell from this record that the San Francisco Superior Court was ever aware that this individual was on probation or suspended, right?
Actually, Your Honor, I would respectfully disagree.
Good. So tell me where that is in the record.
The 300 pages of interest materials that were reviewed, you know, if we're starting from a large universe of 1,200 pages, there was an in-camera review conducted by the Superior Court.
Was the record kept of what was reviewed?
It's not in this record, but I would assume, and certainly on EDPA review, there is a strong level of deference that the state court is presumed to know the law and follow the law. So the absence of any evidence as to that, I don't think can be...
Well, the reason the question is raised is not because I'm bending over backwards to second guess. It's just there's an omission, it seems to me, in the state court's order. It just doesn't reflect to me to be the main point that he's raising, which is that this individual was severely disciplined.
Your Honor, what I think is important is not just the three paragraphs under discovery of new Brady evidence in the Superior Court's order, but the footnote that they dropped saying, for purposes of the order, the Brady material is only briefly described. The petition includes exhibits that provide much more detail regarding the investigations. And I think given that they dropped
not
that...
Not necessarily about the result of the investigation, which is that this individual was put on probation for 5 years.
But that's
suspended for a period of time, and that these had to do with... This went to his veracity, counsel.
But, Your Honor, the suspension and the 5 years of probation was included in those 300 pages.
Do we know
of
that?
Brady
that's what I need, and the California Supreme Court has indicated that that record must be maintained, so that's why I asked the question, counsel.
Yes, Your Honor, the information about his suspension and his probation, that's how Petitioner's counsel found out about it.
No, you're answering a different question. My question is my understanding that the California Supreme Court has said that the custodian must keep a record of what was given to the Superior Court, so we know that the Superior Court had everything, because of course the judge is going to give it the best shot, and then that we have a record of what the judge reviewed generated by the judge. So in terms of just fact-finding process under EDPA, I'm trying to figure out whether those steps were taken, sir.
The current record does not contain that information about the in-camera review. What we have is the detailed letters that the DA in charge of the Brady unit and who is overseeing this whole process had back and forth. We don't have the specific itemized information, but out of that 1,200 pages, the Superior Court conducted the in-camera review. That's unquestioned.
Right.
Found the 300 pages that were most relevant, and those 300 pages were properly considered and reviewed by the San Francisco Superior Court, and that's why I think that footnote is so important. Did they go through and provide an itemized paragraph-by-paragraph summary of all 300 pages of Brady material?
Not required, counsel, and not a helpful comment. I'm looking for the inventory. I mean, in fairness, that is what the California Supreme Court has required, and it gives me a lot of concern that this process that's in place, which I'm sure you acknowledge is very important Brady material here, and it never raised a flag about Gardner.
I think there's an important...
How did that happen?
There's an important kind of temporal aspect of this, which is in 2005, there was not a procedure for obtaining, for the district attorney's office to obtain these petition materials from the San Francisco Police Department, which is the custodian of those records. In 2010, the San Francisco Police Department, San Francisco DA's office, established the Brady Appellate Unit that now routinely goes through and finds any petition materials that would otherwise be confidential under California law. And that disclosure of that information is what led to this habeas petition on the Brady claim.
For this individual, will these always be produced anytime he testifies?
Going forward, yes. And in fact, they've also been disclosed.
So you're not taking the position that the Superior Court seems to have taken, which is that the fraudulent statements would have had to pertain to this individual's case before they're material for purposes of Brady.
I don't think that there's a categorical finding that any collateral impeachment evidence could never constitute Brady material on the facts of this case.
What was the answer to my question? I'm sorry, I missed it.
I don't think that there was a categorical finding that collateral impeachment evidence generally could never make out a Brady.
My question is whether or not it's the state's position. I think I'm not asking a good question, sorry. My question is just whether it's the state's position that in order for material to be, in order for information to be material within the meaning of the statute, not within the meaning of Brady, because those are two different things, in other words, discoverable. In order for it to be discoverable, does it have to be information relating to veracity pertaining to a particular defendant's own case?
The practice that we are using here, and I'm speaking on behalf of, you know, the prosecution writ large here,
sure,
is certainly to be more flexible in the discovery of those materials, including here, the 300 pages of Brady materials that were discovered ultimately were found by the Superior Court not to have been material, and yet we still thought that it was necessary to disclose those to the defense.
So what's more flexible mean? I'm just trying to figure out if you're taking the hardline position that I thought I understood from your briefing, and if it's been misrepresented or just misunderstood in the briefing, that's all I'm looking for.
I think that there's a different standard applied to when we decide to disclose information that could potentially be material.
What is that standard, counsel?
I think that information that could potentially have collaterally impeached the inspector. And just to be clear, it's not our determination as to what information is being disclosed. This was in response to a request that the district attorney's office made to the police department. They turned over all 1,200 potential Brady's type material. That then went to, under California state law, is submitted for in-camera review by the Superior Court, which did its own review. We haven't seen any of these other 900 pages. We're in exactly the same position as
petitioners. Counsel, it's your representation that all 1,200 pages were turned over. It's your representation that the entire universe was 1,200 pages. That's what I'm trying to get at. And that's why I asked whether those steps were taken. But I think your answer is you don't know.
It's both our representation and petitioner's counsel in his briefing talks about the 1,200 pages that were supplied.
It's not his representation. I just asked him the question about whether we have, again, if I misunderstood, by all means jump in. But my understanding is that what he confirmed is that the California Supreme Court has required the records custodian to maintain a record of what was delivered to the Superior Court, and the Superior Court keep a record of what was inspected in camera, and that he can't tell whether that was done.
I have no reason to believe that those records were not maintained because that was not a live issue before this. We didn't augment the record with it, but petitioner's counsel certainly didn't include that as evidence that those proper steps were not contained. And I think it's worth emphasizing that the thoroughness of the analysis by the Superior Court, this is not a cursory review as we see in some other state habeas court opinions where it's, you know, here's the claim, no prima facie case for relief. Here's the claim, no prima facie case for relief. This was an 11-page order, a thorough exploration of the facts of the case, a detailed analysis of the binding Supreme Court precedent, Smith against Kane and Strickler against Green, two cases on opposite sides. They cited the three-part Brady test, and then they analyzed, they gave a summary of what the Brady material was. They dropped that footnote, which I think is incredibly important.
I hear everything you're saying, but you know, this case just stinks. This impeachment material was just devastating. Anybody looking at it would have known that it was devastating. As I understand, what happened is that the prosecutor didn't have it because the police department didn't give it to him, and the police department knew damn well the effect that this evidence would have. So he convicted a guy on pretty slender evidence. He's able to bring a non-frivolous Jackson motion. The evidence against him is so slender. If this had been introduced at trial, I think he would have been acquitted. And now you can argue, based upon sort of post hoc, sort of cleaning up and looking at the district, what the Superior Court did, that you guys skate on it. This just stinks.
Well, Your Honor, I would respectfully submit that under AEDPA and its highly deferential standard of review,
that's why it stinks.
That the Superior Court's order was not unreasonable, both the factual determinations and the legal analysis. And I believe.
Counsel, when you say that, forgive me for interrupting, but I want to make sure I'm getting it. Are you looking at ER 34 when you say that?
When I say what?
That the factual representations are not cursory and so forth.
That's correct.
Okay, so this says on line 12 of that page. Well, let's start at 11. In 1997, several officers asked Inspector Gardner to help them prepare for an assistant inspector exam. He met with an officer the day before the exam. That officer revealed to Gardner that he had answers to the exam and knew what scenarios would be presented. Gardner provided this information to the unit administering the test. Well, that's literally true, but of course, as you know, there's considerable more detail. If that were the case, he surely wouldn't have been disciplined in the way he was. And then the test was canceled. In the next line down here, about 16:17, it says Gardner admitted he lied during the investigation to protect himself. I mean, that's it. And in fact, what we know now is that he repeatedly lied, and some evidence was destroyed. And it's very, very serious. Serious enough that the police department, I think very correctly, wound up imposing a very serious sanction.
Your Honor, I see that I'm over time, but can I respond to your question?
Yeah, you're fine.
I need to answer as long as we need to answer.
And so the problem I've got between that and the other thing I want to make sure that I'm not missing, because you'll know the record better than I, is that the other thing that doesn't appear in this Superior Court order, counsel, is any acknowledgement of the punishment that he received. Now, if you read this, it really becomes possible to, except for the acknowledgement that he admitted he lied at least once, it really looks like he's kind of the hero turning these guys in, and that's not the way this played out at all. So what do I do about that? That's why I'm asking you all of these questions about the fact-finding process and what did the Superior Court judge know. I have no intention of impugning the Superior Court. I was a Superior Court judge. I know about doing these in-camera inspections very, very earnestly, but the Superior Court can only work with what it's given. And so can you help me out with this?
Well, Your Honor, again, the Superior Court was given all 300 pages of the Brady material, the universe that we are dealing with here as well on appeal. So there is no, given that footnote that was dropped and this summary of the key findings, there's no reason to find that they were ignorant of the other findings.
Judge Kristen asked specifically earlier whether in those 300 pages there's a reference to the fact that he was on probation, and I didn't hear an answer. Is there? Can you give us a cite to where the Superior Court would have seen a document that said he was on probation?
I don't have a cite for that offhand, but I am very confident because the pages that I reviewed in preparing this brief were the same 300 pages or the 150 pages of amongst those 300 pages, and that's where we got the information for that. So I'm perfectly happy to submit supplemental, briefing on the fact that that was included in there, but it is absolutely my understanding that that was contained within there. And if I just might say, I think the part of the reason the Superior Court may have focused on the lying to the investigating officers about this was because those were the two charges that were actually sustained.
As opposed to all the others that weren't after there was sort of a negotiation. So this comes back to the other point that I've got, which is very concerning to me, that this was never flagged. This wasn't just an allegation going to his veracity. This had come to a conclusion, and there was a finding, and there was a very serious disciplinary action imposed. And whatever process is in place, which is a bit of a black box for us here on appeal, a flag was not raised as to this individual counsel. Why was that?
The state law was complied by. Pitchess does establish the confidentiality of these officer records, and so the police department was the custodian at the time in 2005. This now going forward has been changed, and now the DA's office works collaboratively with the police department since 2010.
Okay, that's good, but why wasn't this raised then? You're not taking the position that Brady didn't require it to be raised then, surely?
No, and whether or not this was, we have admitted that this information was suppressed. The second prong of Brady we have acknowledged. We've admitted that it's favorable, and we've admitted that it's suppressed.
Right, I'm asking a slightly different question, and I don't mean to belabor the point, and maybe you don't have an answer for me, which is possible, but the question is, you both simultaneously want me to be reassured that there's this process in place now, which I appreciate truly very much, but whatever the process is, this wasn't flagged. And it's not a subtle violation, it's egregious. So do you have an answer about why it is that this was not presented to the DA's office?
I have spoken to the prosecuting district attorney, and the answer that he gave me was in 2005, they did not have a procedure for getting these types of pitches materials that are confidential under state law. That was the answer that he gave me.
So the consequence is the police department gets to hide information that they know is devastating to their case, and now they get a conviction, and now you're defending it. they get a conviction, which I'm quite sure they would not have gotten had this information come out. Maybe the prosecutor wouldn't even have been brought if the prosecutor had to confront that evidence and say, here's my star witness, and look what they're going to do to him on the stand.
Well, Your Honor, I would point out that in light of the factual impossibility of this frame-up theory that was discussed earlier, I believe that...
Excuse me. So we all know what juries will do when they get really angry at one side or the other. We see it repeatedly in criminal cases. If the jury decides that the other side is just playing too fast and loose with whatever it is, they'll just quit. I think they probably would have in this case.
Your Honor, I am not aware of any cases that have speculated as to how a jury might have punished the prosecution because of any perceived lack of credibility by the officer.
Look at the O.J. case. You look at that glove, bingo case is over.
Your Honor, I don't believe it.
He's obviously guilty, and that jury looked at the police behavior and said, we acquit.
Your Honor, the O.J. case, with all due respect, was not binding U.S. Supreme Court authority that can be the basis for habeas relief.
I'm only telling you, this is what common sense for experienced lawyers will tell you.
I think it's also important to look at Inspector Layden, who was unimpeached, who provided corroborating evidence for a lot of that
information. No, I do have a question about Inspector Layden. Sure. Thank you for reminding me, because he did come back, and there's, several representations in your brief about the fact that he was also present on the day, is it 2 days later when the newspaper was found? Thanks. But it doesn't tell me what that means. Present, as in they both went to the premises, which, of course, is two different buildings, several different rooms, or was he right there? Is there any place in the record that tells me he was present when the newspaper was located?
Yes, Your Honor. Inspector Layden testified at sixth volume of the RT, 1574.
Okay, hold on 1 second. This takes me just a second. Volume 6.
What's the ER page again? I'm sure.
It's in the, it's not in the ER, it's in the larger record that was before the district court, it's before this.
I'll find it.
1574.
Volume 6, 1574.
Correct.
And that will tell me that he was, that Layden was present and could have made this observation himself of the discovery of the newspaper?
Correct. I can read this a couple lines of...
Great, that would be helpful.
It's on cross-examination by defense counsel. On April 9th, 2003, you were out at Rumpus, room area behind Lang's jewelry store, looking at the area with Inspector Gardner, correct? Answer, yes. Question, and when you were there, Inspector Gardner pointed out a Chronicle newspaper that he saw on a ledge, correct? Answer, when he pointed out the ledge, and there was a Chronicle and a newspaper there.
Thank you.
So, just in conclusion, given the factual impossibility of the frame-up theory, the corroboration by Inspector Layden, whose credibility has never been impeached, and the other corroborating evidence, we believe that even if this collateral impeachment evidence had been presented to the jury, they would not have bought the theory, given the factual impossibility and the other evidence. And given all of that, reasonable for the Superior Court to have concluded that this evidence was not material under Brady. Thank you.
Well, we've taken the other side well over. Why don't we put 3 minutes on the clock and see what happens?
Thank you. I appreciate it. First of all, with regard to deferential review, I don't think there's any basis to conclude that the state court followed Kyle's in terms of examining the Brady evidence item by item and cumulatively. In fact, I think in that part of the order that the court pointed out, there's no way you can conclude that. It seems like most of the evidence was completely ignored. Number two, I would just like to say that we have no idea how many pages were turned over to the state court judge by the police department. There's just no record of that anywhere. Number three, the attorney general represented us to what the district attorney knew. There's nothing in the record as to that either. And in fact, the district attorney in this case and Officer Gardner had a long relationship over decades. And Gardner testified that the whole Hall of Justice was up in arms over this scandal. So you really have, it's strange credulity to conclude that the prosecutor didn't know about this.
Gardner testified where that the Hall of Justice was up in arms.
That's in the record. I'm sorry, that was in the 1997 interview of Gardner. I don't have a pin site right in front of me.
You've told me what I need to know. Thank you.
Yes. I think, we try to get discovery as to whether the district attorney knew. This court has said that that's relevant, but we were denied that discovery below.
It's a Brady violation even if the prosecutor didn't know.
That's correct. That's correct.
It makes it sound worse, feel worse to have the lawyers cheating as well as the prosecutor, as well as the police.
Correct.
But it's sufficient for Brady that the police didn't hand it over.
And I don't think there's any indication that the DA didn't know here, right? You're not suggesting that, are you?
Well, I'm suggesting that they have a long-standing relationship and that the Hall of Justice was up in arms and this was a major scandal, so...
I heard that part. Okay.
Right. So, but, again, we try to get information as to that. With regard to Layden, his testimony on 1674 is actually ambiguous because...
Is it 1574?
It's 1674.
Okay, go ahead.
And he basically says Gardner pointed out the newspaper on the ledge. We don't know if Layden was in another room and Gardner called him over or something like that. Yeah, this is, again, what... The question that may have been asked if the Brady material had been disclosed, but we don't, you know, the testimony as it stands is ambiguous. And I would like to point out that, you know, the Brady material here was devastating because he corrupted other officers. He told other officers to lie. He told other officers to destroy evidence. So to rely on his partner here, I think, is a mistake.
But you didn't have any plausible theory that I read about how they got that early morning edition of the newspaper with both sets of prints on it. Could have planted it, even if you think this individual was really devious and really willing to plant evidence, which is an extraordinary allegation, to be sure. But what's the theory that could have made that possible?
Well, you know, in Kyle's, for example, there was a planting theory. So planting theories can be, you know, kind of extraordinary, but they can also result in a reasonable probability. But I think what Judge Fletcher said is correct, which is that if this kind of material came in, the jury would say, we can't trust this evidence. We can't rely on this evidence.
You're relying on jury nullification.
Well, I don't think it's nullification. I think it's just disbelieving the prosecution when the main prosecution investigator is a liar.
But, I mean, I just don't even know the science. I mean, is it possible to plant a fingerprint?
I don't think that's in the record one way or the other, whether that's possible.
It seems like a horrible Brady violation happened here, but if that evidence had come in, I think we have to kind of think about what the universe would have looked like, and there still would have had to be an explanation of how the evidence came about.
Well, yeah, and again, this is the defense theory, but if this evidence had come in, maybe we wouldn't have never even gotten to the defense theory. Maybe it's just that you can't believe this guy. He's the key investigator. He's thoroughly impeached. And I think that this goes to a broader point, and I'll make it quickly, which is that, you know, if the state court's decision is permitted to stand here, what message is being sent to prosecutors in future cases as to impeachment material? What message is being sent to police? What message is being sent to communities who are the most affected by police misconduct? The message that would be sent is that even if an officer has a history of lies, falsification of evidence, and destruction of evidence, it can be hidden from the defense. And that, I respectfully submit, is not due process. It's plain wrong. Smith had a fundamental right to have the jury evaluate all the evidence in his case, including evidence regarding Gardner's prior lies and misconduct. And by suppressing that evidence here, the prosecution denied him his right to due process. For that reason, the court should reverse.
Okay. Thank both sides for their arguments. Case of Smith versus Chappell, now submitted for decision.